This is the American Law Journal.
One is a television series about the so-called trial of the century. Another, a documentary of an alleged innocent man framed by police. While the third is the story of an American icon playing out in real time in our courts. What do all three together at this time have to say about our criminal justice system? Good evening. This is the American Law Journal. I'm Christopher Naughton. O.J. Simpson, Bill Cosby, Making a Murderer. What raw nerve do they all touch in America's psyche today? Gina Passarella explains.
Here they come. After 18 years.
How are you doing?
Oh, hello.
How are you?
Oh, pretty good.
How's it feel?
It was wonderful.
Oh, God, save me.
I was happy when I got out. I thought I was the happiest man on earth.
We knew he was innocent. We knew he was innocent.
Making a Murderer, the television series all the rage on Netflix, is the story of a man unjustly accused, perhaps twice. The Cosby trial now rivets the nation, with the public divided as to his guilt or innocence. But neither would have had the impact without O.J. Now memorialized in the FX series, the O.J. Simpson trial still casts its shadow over criminal justice, starting with evidence.
In Making a Murderer, it's an extension of the O.J. Simpson trial. We've got this focus on forensic evidence.
The general public does have an expectation. We used to call it the CSI effect, where every case should have DNA now.
The O.J. trial was also about fame and money, how they can influence justice.
We see periodically over the years people with greater access to money having greater access to a kind of justice which favors the wealthy.
So I think power, fame, and money warp the space around it, and I think judges are not immune to that.
If anything, O.J. was about race.
I think the justice system right now frequently has to deal with race as an issue. Simpson was just an exemplar of that issue, but it's raised in many cases.
And O.J., Cosby, and Making a Murderer share suspicion of something else.
Then there's the issue of police misconduct. In Making a Murderer, I think that the title is clearly insinuating that the county framed him as a murderer.
I've had cases of my own where I prosecuted where I, frankly, was extremely suspicious of police planting it. It was by far the exception rather than the rule, and when it happens, it's deeply, deeply troubling.
Is it conceivable that police planted evidence in Stephen Avery's case? Will race play a role in the trial of an African-American icon once beloved by both white and black communities? Long after O.J., these questions linger, telling us that as far as the criminal justice system has come in 20 years, we've got a long way to go. For the American Law Journal, I'm Gina Passarella.
All right, five guests with me tonight. Let's go ahead and meet them. Sayde Ladov joins us for the first time, former Philadelphia Bar Chancellor. She recently participated in the bar's discussion of O.J. to Cosby and what it says about race, media, and the law today. She is a partner with Dolchin, Slotkin, and Todd in Philadelphia. Linda Dale Hoffa is a former federal prosecutor and Justice Department spokesperson in the Timothy McVeigh Oklahoma City bombing matter. Today, she's a white-collar criminal defense attorney with Dilworth Paxson. Glennis Clark joined me on the set 20 years ago, the very night of the O.J. Simpson criminal verdict. He's a former prosecutor and now a criminal defense attorney for many years. Dennis McAndrews is also a former prosecutor in the DuPont murder trial, which is the basis of the movie Foxcatcher, now in private practice with McAndrews Law. And John Morganelli prosecuted Robert Durst and other high-profile defendants in his 20-plus years as the DA in Northampton County. John, a regular on this program now for over two decades. Let's go back 20 years ago. This is from the Oprah Winfrey Show on the very day of the announcement of the O.J. verdict.
In the matter of the people of the state of California versus Orenthal James Simpson, case number BA097211. We, the jury, in the above entitled action, find the defendant Orenthal James Simpson not guilty of the crime of murder in violation of Penal Code Section 187A, a felony upon Nicole Brown Simpson, a human being, as charged in count one of the information.
As I sit and watch that from 20 years ago, I can still feel the chills. You could almost argue that the same reaction we saw in that studio 20 years ago could happen today.
Absolutely, it could happen today. And it may well happen with Bill Cosby. There are going to be those folks who say that Bill Cosby is being unjustly prosecuted because there was an agreement not to prosecute, that so much time has elapsed, that how can the victims now all of a sudden come forward en masse and claim that they were sexually abused, that they were given roofies or other drugs and then date raped? Or there are going to be those people who will say, this is a black man being prosecuted by a white prosecutor, that he did do something wrong, as in the Constand case, but they are not prosecuting him, they are persecuting him.
And so maybe, Glenn Clark, Justice Roberts has it wrong. We're not living in a post-racial America.
Absolutely, he's got it wrong. I mean, all you got to do is look at the political climate that we have in America today from a political standpoint. It's worse than it was probably 20 years ago. The thing that's happening now, though, is right-thinking, smart Americans are seeing the true fabric of what America is all about. It is still race-driven to a large extent.
Take a quick look here at the Washington Post. White people believe the justice system is colorblind. Black people really don't. That's from a Gallup poll. And then also from the Pew poll, 1 out of 4 black men under 35 say they were mistreated by police in the last 30 days. Of all the things we're going to talk about, Linda, this may be the most poignant, the most riveting.
It is a very depressing statistic that you just cited, but it is true today. It was true back then, 20 years ago in the OJ case. It was very surprising to us. Most of us didn't expect that the reaction to the jury verdict was going to be along racial lines, and it was. Today, that will not surprise us. Race does play a part in our criminal justice system, and more people are aware of it as time goes on.
I think, though, that we have to look at the Cosby trial through a lens of just the Cosby trial. I don't think it's the OJ trial. It's not any other trial. It is one man with a huge amount of both black and white women who are coming forward and saying that he sexually abused them. So I don't think the racial divide is going to be quite the same in this case as it was in OJ. And, you know, we can look at the influence of money. I think money is actually far more important in the criminal justice system than race. Race plays a role. There are far too many African Americans in prison today. But many black defendants who have been wealthy have avoided criminal conviction. OJ's one. Don King was another. Michael Jackson was another. The influence of money is far more important.
And that's a very interesting thread through all three of these events, if you will. You're talking about money that OJ Simpson had. You're also talking about perhaps tens of millions, and I think Joe McGettigan, your partner, said maybe over $100 million that Bill Cosby has. That money does buy the best defense. And again, just juxtapose that with Making a Murderer with Stephen Avery. At least early on, he did not have the kind of money to, if you will, purchase an attorney who was going to represent him. And his nephew, Brandon Dassey, had a public defender represent him. And that turned horribly, horribly wrong. John Morganelli, probably one of the more horrific stories we've seen when it comes to public defenders.
Well, I certainly think there was lots of upsetting things that happened in the Avery case. But, you know, I think it's each of these cases have to be looked at on their own merits. And I do agree that race plays a role in our criminal justice system. But as we noted, when O.J. was acquitted on the Oprah show, all the black folks were cheering and all the white folks were sort of sitting there with a shocked look on their face. It's about perception. And sometimes perception is not reality. And what's injustice to one group of folks is justice to another. And that's the difficulty we have right now, I think, in the United States criminal justice system.
Let's take a listen here to Dean Strang, who's one of the defense attorneys in Making a Murderer.
I didn't see them plant evidence with my own two eyes. I didn't see it. But do I understand how human beings might be tempted to plant evidence after Stephen's exoneration, of the lawsuit, of the Avery Commission, of the governor hugging Stephen and holding him up as an example of the criminal justice system gone wrong? Do I have any difficulty understanding what human emotions might have driven police officers to want to augment or confirm their beliefs that he must have killed Theresa Halbach? I don't have any difficulty understanding those human emotions at all.
You know, Dennis, I think you went on record as saying that as a former prosecutor, perhaps the worst moments that you experienced as a prosecutor was when you suspected police of planting evidence. Rare, but it happened.
Right, and it is rare. But when you see it and when you feel it and you have that understanding in your bones that you believe it's occurred, but frankly, you can't prove it, it's a very difficult position for a prosecutor, because as a prosecutor, your job is to do justice. And so you're confronted with a situation where the facts are pointing in one direction, the officer's testimony is in another. And in those cases, more often than not, you have to let the jury decide. And frankly, I found the juries to be very, very good about that. And they see through it.
Also, just not when they plant evidence, but when also police lie. And the prosecutor's job, if they discover either, is that they have to dismiss the charges and also report this breach of conduct to internal affairs by the police.
And that's too many times, they just don't do that, though.
I've been
in court hearings where, you know, I can talk to the prosecutor, and we agree that the facts that they're laying out there are not the accurate facts. So the prosecutor then has a duty, a responsibility, mm-hmm. to not let that witness, I don't care if he's a police officer or not, offer testimony in that circumstance, and he goes ahead and does it anyhow. When I say he, the prosecutor.
And that's one of the tragedies of our criminal justice system right now, and it has been systemic, that until we can have prosecutors locally, statewide, federally, who care and understand that their mission is to do justice, and they should not be afraid to decline a prosecution.
Well, that I was never afraid to decline a prosecution. I don't think Linda was ever afraid to decline.
The
problem is
that
when you just don't know it. You have a suspicion, but you don't know it. And I would never, ever knowingly put on a witness who I knew to be telling a lie. But it's not always clear. It's not always black and white. And those are the particularly difficult situations. I tell you, the prosecutors that I worked with, I did not know any that suborned perjury or any that knowingly put on perjury.
Well,
but there are times that you
blessed.
Have, and I don't think it's systemic. I think it is the exception rather than the rule, but we have to be vigilant.
Let's take a quick look here from the People versus O.J. Simpson, again, the current FX series. And this is Marsha Clark making her case that not only would the LAPD investigators have to have been racist, they would have had to have been magicians.
Furman made up his mind at Bundy that Simpson did it, even though he had no idea if O.J. had an ironclad alibi that would then ruin Furman's career and land him in jail. Furman takes the glove at Bundy, makes sure it has Goldman and Nicole's DNA on it, jumps in the car with the other detectives, heads to Rockingham with it, where he gets into the Bronco, somehow getting all that evidence in it, including Simpson's blood. Even though the police didn't have Simpson's blood until the next day. Then he goes over the wall, plants the glove behind Cato's room. Then, with the help of the rest of his super secret cabal of OJ-hating racist cops, he starts getting everything just so. Just where it needs to be. Nicole and Ron and OJ's blood into OJ's bedroom. OJ's blood back to Bundy. Oh, and OJ's Broncos fibers back to Bundy too.
John, back in the day, you weren't able to put that kind of a soliloquy together, certainly not in video, but imagine if she could have.
Well, that whole argument, which is the frame-up theory, that O.J. was framed up, was put together very well in a book by Bugliosi, former prosecutor in Los Angeles, in a book called Outrage. And he talks about how that argument should have been made and how easy it is for a prosecutor, and I've done it myself, to destroy a frame-up argument. Because as she points out in that clip, it's not just one person. There has to be numerous people involved in the frame-up, and the defendant has to help in the frame-up. So if that argument had been made at trial, as Bugliosi points out in his book Outrage, I think they could have destroyed the whole frame-up argument, as often it is easily to be put aside by a prosecutor.
I think you recognize as well as anyone that Furman was the problem. Furman was the problem, and his history was the problem. And so when they began to examine him closely and his prior behavior, it put the prosecutors on a slippery slope.
Well, it did.
And when it puts you on a slippery slope, then you can start making some arguments that you otherwise would not be able to avail yourself to.
Well, look, it was a brilliant defense. And
right.
It sidetracked all the evidence.
That's
that's what the good defense lawyers do.
Right.
And as a prosecutor, you cannot say, okay, all right, I have a problem with Furman, so let's just put him aside and focus on the rest of the evidence. Because the jury, now you have destroyed your credibility as a prosecutor. They don't believe you anymore. And the jury is not going to put aside something like Furman's racism and the lies he had about that.
Right, and it just tainted the entire process.
It did.
So what happens with Furman is that the jury's focus goes to that and his nonsense.
Right.
And then it's easy to make that argument.
Sure, the game is over here, guys.
Yeah.
It's not over here.
Right. And well, that's what defense lawyers do.
Well, and they tell the
story. And you can't discount the fact that this came in the wake of the Rodney King beating and acquittal.
Well,
so all of that
fed
into the same situation and had to color the verdict and the thinking of the jurors.
And it's shown really well in the docudrama that the prosecutor was not prepared for this defense, and she didn't know how to respond to it, and she didn't recognize it as a valid concern to be raised. When they raised the racism issue.
Nor did she recognize how to deal appropriately with the DNA evidence. Sitting here, a group of five very polished lawyers, we all know that you never ask a question that you don't know the answer to. You don't get suckered into permitting a demonstration where you don't know the outcome. I mean, how many other things could have gone wrong? We can say that OJ was a reaction to Rodney King. Can we say, or will we say, that Cosby will be a reaction to Ferguson and all the things that have transpired since Ferguson up to the point of the Cosby trial?
Right. We don't have planted evidence in this matter.
Well, it's not being tried in Ferguson. If Cosby was being tried in Ferguson, I'd be much more concerned about that.
Don't you think there's a shadow? But I mean, but nationally, don't you think that shadow is fairly extensive?
It's extensive, but it's not going to create the same kind of atmosphere as Rodney King in Los Angeles. This is Montgomery County, a suburban Philadelphia county, and frankly, Ferguson is 1,500 miles away, and it's not going to be uppermost in jury
minds. So, Dennis, are you talking?
I disagree with you more.
Are you talking about the kind of jury that they may be able to pick in Montgomery County versus the kind they had in the city of Los Angeles?
It's not the same news cycle. It's not the same news event in Montgomery County as it was. It's not necessarily the race of the jurors. It's more about the attention of the jurors on that type of issue. Ferguson was big news, but it's not the kind of thing that affected people in Montgomery County. Tip O'Neill said, "All politics is local. All news is local." This was a Ferguson event, and it's not going to be something that's going to impact the Montgomery County.
Respectfully, I could not disagree with you more. And I think that, candidly, what you're saying insults the intelligence of a Montgomery County jury.
Oh, it does not insult anybody's intelligence.
Let me finish, please.
I've picked juries in Montgomery County, including blacks, and they're not going to be affected by Ferguson.
Do you mean to tell me that the people in Montgomery County have been living under a rock that they don't remember quasi-military vehicles rolling down the streets of Ferguson? Do you mean to tell me that nobody in Montgomery County reads the New York Times and saw what happened to Freddie Gray in Staten Island? I mean, come on.
You took those words right out of your mouth. I didn't say any such thing. The people in Montgomery County are certainly aware of it, but they're not going to be affected by it. They're not going to decide Bill Cosby's fate on whether police were brutal in Montgomery County. Bill Cosby's fate is going to be decided upon the witnesses that are in that case.
But the one thing we haven't talked about in Cosby is the celebrity factor.
Yeah.
And I think that is huge. Now, the OJ had the celebrity factor, and Cosby has the celebrity factor.
Yes.
People have loved him, and they have adored him. But when there is a high-profile celebrity case, there is almost like another dynamic in the courtroom that's going on. It's almost as though everybody is playing in that courtroom, the judge, the defense attorney, the prosecutor, for their 15 minutes of fame. And it just skews everything, and it is not like a regular, normal trial.
But aren't you saying, didn't that exactly the same thing happen in O.J. Simpson? Again, if you look at the series, it looks like, pardon my expression, but it looks like Judge Ito is a media prostitute.
As you know, as a prosecutor, you play to the jury. It is all about the jury. Do they get it? Do they understand it? Do they hear you? Do they care? And are they with you? But when the cameras are in the courtroom and there's a celebrity there, everybody's playing to the camera. And when you saw Making a Murderer, after the day's trial, everybody went out and had a press conference. Every single day they had a press conference, and they're all spinning what happened in the courtroom. They were playing to the trial as though the public was going to decide it and not those jurors in the box.
Because things are very much different today to this extent. With all the social media, you know, you got all these zillions of so-called reporters and journalists who are feeding information in Montgomery County, any county, mm-hmm. about their opinion about whether Bill Cosby is guilty or not. Mm-hmm. And this jury is getting bombarded with this information. Look, the question I have is, if you're going to prosecute Bill Cosby, let's do it in a timely fashion. Let's not file the information on the last day that you can file it. I mean, come on, guys. I mean,
again, that's the thread through all three of these events, and mm-hmm. that is it's police or prosecutorial misconduct or the allegations thereof. And it could even be in the Cosby matter that what is ginning this case up is politics. Kevin Steele ran on this issue.
Right.
Bruce Castor did not prosecute Bill Cosby. We're going to go ahead and do that. So you could allege that there's not prosecutorial misconduct, but maybe misfeasance, if not malfeasance.
And didn't you find it extraordinary that Bruce Castor did not put this agreement in writing?
John Morganelli tells me, John, you say you never put agreements like this in writing.
Well, it makes no sense for the prosecutor to put something like this in writing. That would be the job of the defense lawyer. If I'm representing a client, I certainly want it in writing, but I don't see any reason in the world why Castor would have memorialized this. It wasn't to his benefit to memorialize it. I know he's been criticized for it, but it really was the defense counsel's duty to do that. In a case like this, I think it was incumbent on Cosby's lawyer to get this in writing or go before a judge and make a record of it to protect his defending of Cosby. Had he done that, we might be in a different juncture right now.
And John, if I can just jump in here, I think that is true what you were saying with regard to a declination decision by a prosecutor. I've decided to exercise my prosecutorial discretion. I'm not going to charge this particular matter. And so you close your file, it's an internal memo, maybe you don't even have a memo, and you close it. But you know, John, that tomorrow, next week, new evidence comes up, change of circumstances, that you can open that file if you're still within the statute of limitations.
Right.
But here, this was something very different. Bruce Castor was saying that it was a promise forever to never prosecute.
That's what he said.
And that's extraordinary.
It's extraordinary, but in my opinion, it was more incumbent on the defense counsel to get that in writing to protect his client. Castor had no duty to protect Cosby on this thing.
And Linda, maybe we're finding out that a promise is not an agreement. Let me take you back 20 years ago. Glenn Clark, I'm going to put you on the spot, embarrass you maybe a little bit. Let's go back 20 years ago, because again, when that O.J. Simpson verdict came down in the criminal matter, you and I were sitting here on the set. Brace yourself. Let's take a look.
The prosecution was in trouble in this case right from the start. Because most people, and I don't care where you are, and I don't think it has anything to do with the racial composition of the jury, they're looking for the blood and guts. They're looking for the smoking gun. They want some hard physical evidence to tie them in. When you trot out a case based upon DNA or other scientific data, the fact of the matter is that most people walking the streets don't understand that evidence. It's boring. It puts you to sleep.
So let me ask you, Glenn Clark, after 20 years down the road, a little bit more wisdom, a little bit more perspective, would you change your answer taking a look at that 20 years later?
The world has changed, man. You mentioned DNA and the defense lawyers and everybody runs for cover. You know, when the DA says he's got DNA, it's ball
game. But 20 years ago, it wasn't enough.
Why?
Because DNA was still in its infancy, right?
It's infancy, beginning. People were beginning to understand it. Some courts had not yet even agreed that it would be good
and
evidence.
And Barry Scheck purposely put him to sleep.
Well, he put him to sleep, but...
And it worked.
It worked.
And it worked.
But Chris, today with CSI, every juror expects now all kinds of forensic evidence.
And now the prosecutors, they start asking questions like that. Oh, you're not going to hold us against us now if we don't have no DNA, right? So now the total thing of physical, scientific evidence has completely switched. So I stand by what I said then, but...
in that time period, in that context. But today would be different.
In today's environment, it would be very much different.
And going back again to the FX series, here's David Schwimmer, who I think, you know, played the part, if you will, of Robert Kardashian to a T. I think he did a brilliant job. Here he is with doubts because of the DNA.
I'm really struggling here, AC. I mean, even when... It seems everybody else has stopped working to figure out who did it. I keep going over everything again and again. Everything I know about Nicole, everything I can learn about Ron Goldman. I mean, there's never been more information, more media coverage, more detectives, more even the kooks, all about one thing, one crime, ever, ever. And there's just nothing. No other suspect.
After that event took place 20 years ago, they polled America. 70% of white people thought that O.J. was guilty. 30% of black people thought he was guilty. Lots of people could identify with Robert Kardashian in that scene.
Kardashian is saying really probably what the jurors are thinking. Who did this? And when I was thinking about making a murderer in that case, I think that the jurors probably had the hardest time figuring out. We don't understand who could have done it but him. There was nothing plausible. Even if the cops were planting evidence, they couldn't even imagine that the cops had murdered this young woman. So who could have murdered her? And it only came to one answer for them. And they didn't have another alternative as to who could have murdered that young gal.
And yet at the same time, Linda, we've heard Dean Strang say something to this effect. It's possible that these two ideas can exist in the same universe, mm-hmm. that Stephen Avery may have committed the crime and police planted evidence. Mm. Maybe the same thing in the OJ trial, and if both of those things exist, the jury are going to say not guilty.
Because the government has lost their faith. I mean, the jurors have lost their faith
right.
in the government.
That's exactly
And what we've often heard, and I think Strang said this as well, it's not often if, and again, it's rare. I would agree with Dennis McAndrews. As a prosecutor, I rarely have ever thought that people planted evidence. But if a policeman was going to plant evidence, it wasn't to make an innocent person guilty. It was often to take a person that they felt or really knew was guilty and try to pile on.
The glove, right. the glove, the glove. You know, whatever you want to say about the OJ trial, what OJ had or who OJ had was Johnny Cochran, simply one of the most brilliant defense lawyers ever. And if you read the book that the O.J. series is based on,
Jeffrey Toobin's book,
and if you watch this series, you can see how the glove demonstration was actually, they baited him into doing the glove demonstration. And when that glove didn't fit, game over. There was your parallel universe, Chris. All evidence points to O.J., but when it comes down to the bottom line, the glove doesn't fit, you must acquit.
One of the things that I think that we need to keep in mind, and maybe this connects all of these cases as well, is the balance between the fact that police work and prosecutorial work must be scrutinized. And we can't be shocked if misconduct has taken place, and we need to hold prosecutors accountable, especially in racial matters. And yet at the same time, and again, all of us here, prosecutors or former prosecutors, we know the good citizens that work for police departments and prosecutors' offices, and to honor them as well. I want to thank my guests tonight because I think this is the perfect way to come full circle from when Glennis Clark and I sat on the set 20 years ago to discuss the O.J. Simpson verdict the day it came down. Sayde Ladov, former chancellor of the Philadelphia Bar Association, Linda Dale Hoffa, former federal prosecutor, now with Dilworth Paxson, Glennis Clark, former prosecutor and criminal trial attorney for many years now, Dennis McAndrews, also a former prosecutor in the DuPont matter, and now with McAndrews Law, and last but certainly not least, our prosecutor tonight, John Morganelli, DA. So for all of us here at the American Law Journal, thank you for joining us this week. Until next Monday night, case closed.
This week's American Law Journal has been made possible in part by Law Catalyst, legal media and marketing for lawyers. Go to lawcatalyst.com. Beatty, Sloan, and DeGeneva, personal attention for those hurt at work or suffering from serious injury. King Spry, serving its Pennsylvania clients in family law, business, personal injury, and school law for over 30 years. Scheller PC, protecting consumer rights since 1977. Blank Rome, providing strategic advice for employers in today's workplace. and the Legal Intelligencer, an American lawyer media company, and the oldest daily legal newspaper in the United States.